I was working out one day, and I went to go reach.
Hilarious.
I was using the pink weights. And I look over to grab a 45-pound plate to put on the end of my squat bar, and I said, hey, the weight's gone. So I go to grab another one. I say, the weight's gone also.
Where are all these heavy weights
going? I'm like, where's all these weights going? And then there she was in the corner. Putting up mad weight.
Mad stacks.
Rachel, you gotta leave some weight for other people at the gym. You're burning through it all.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I mean, you're not using them, so somebody's got to.
I'm using the little lady. I'm using the tiny kid weights.
Yeah,
they're
joining
very small.
Us in studio is Rachel Hare. She is a Baltimore PD crime scene tech.
And Alex, the guy that I work with, FX Under Armour shout out. He's the guy that comes skipping up to me like, do you know what she does? Do you know what Rachel over there does with the 600 pounds on her shoulders? And I said, I don't, but I'd like to find out. A, yep. Mostly because of her leggings. B, because you seem pretty excited. And he's like, she is a crime scene technician that when something pops off that Josh has to do a story about, people are shooting, people are stabbing, people are driving off the road, you got to get there and you got to figure it out.
Yeah, explain to us what you do. Because we see a lot of TV, right? And I would imagine how accurate is a TV show? I don't know. But I have watched like First 48, which is, you know, real life. Are you the people with the little number cards and the brown paper bags and you're collecting evidence and processing and taking photos? Am I in the right?
Yes. So that's what we do. We show up after the police have gotten there and secure the scene because we are not officers. So we're civilians. So that's a common misconception, even though.
Because you got the whole, your blue kind of, I don't know what you call those.
Uniform.
Blue uniform, and it's got some badges on it, but not badges, patches.
You look official.
But yeah.
Well, very official. Usually have a vest
too.
Over this. So I usually have a bulletproof vest on.
Whoa. Have you needed it?
Luckily, no, and I really don't want to test it out.
Me neither.
Test
one out.
But yeah, it's obviously not exactly like the TV show because, you know, of course, before every scene, I go get my hair done and my nails done and
right.
Wardrobe comes.
Yeah,
right.
You're beautiful.
Exactly.
You're always holding a Starbucks.
Yeah,
of course.
You always have some zany
right.
pun. Yeah.
But yeah, so, you know, after the scene's been secured and, you know, they give us a call and we show up and we start taking pictures and kind of figure out what's going on, figure out what we need to collect, what we don't need to collect, but the numbers and the letters down and swab the blood and pick up the bullets and the cartridge casings and go and photograph victims at the hospital and whatnot.
Now, I've known some people that have had like a vehicle stolen, and I was actually talking to somebody the other day that had a vehicle stolen.
Yeah, you.
And then you think you're going to call the cops and then they're going to pull up in a van and they're going to start fingerprinting and doing all this and they're going to... That never happens with stolen vehicles, right? Like that's you pretty much get a police report and they go, good luck.
Well, I mean, we can't print the car if it's not there, so.
Well, I mean, after they find it, like when they find it and they go, okay, well, I want to find who took. You want someone's ass. You're like, hey, my car was gone and you got it. You're expecting they're going to be dusting this whole thing. And we're going to get right on this and we're going to find this culprit. And no, not in the city of Baltimore. That's not the highest priority.
We do dust cars, actually.
What?
Yep, we get requests for cars all the time for carjackings and any vehicles that were stolen and then used in a crime.
Okay.
We do, we process cars all the time. Usually we don't like it, especially if it's windy because the powder's going everywhere. You end up looking like a chimney sweep and then you got to use all these fingerprints and whatnot.
Has dusting for fingerprints advanced at all?
Right.
You always see the little, like the makeup applier.
Yeah, the brush.
The brush, has it advanced? Why isn't it more computer-like?
Well, so the actual collecting of it is you still have to collect the physical fingerprint.
Okay.
So there have been advanced techniques for various surfaces and whatnot. But for for basic dusting, it's a basic black powder and a brush and you dust and you lift it. When it comes to the more comparison side, that's where the advances have come with the databases and
now,
the computerization.
Now, do you dust the entire car or do you just dust by the door? Because I'm thinking that maybe a really clever thief would put his fingers on the roof and stretch, like if he's big enough, and stretch, like if he's wearing, like he could touch, he touches the parts of the car that are not dusted by police. Do you get what I'm saying?
No.
Here's the bottom line question. Do you dust the entire car? That's
Well, it depends on the situation. If we have one person who's stealing the car from the driver's seat, we're not going to go dust the passenger side. But we usually dust the entire door frame, roof, and stuff. Right. We'll dust anything on the interior of the car. But it also depends on the surface. I mean,
Now we're joined by BPD crime scene technician Rachel Hare joins us in studio, and I got exactly what you're saying. You don't touch the handles, you don't touch the wheel.
If he's stealing a car, he's got to get into it.
Josh
he's got to drive it. He's not just touching the roof.
He could use his teeth to open the door. Hmm? How about
is he
that?
Opening the door with his tongue?
I wasn't actually serious. I just was kind of.
Now, do you also do that thing with, and obviously, 99.9% of the questions that were asked is all based off of NCIS, Law and Order, all that sort of garbage, where you do the bullet trajectory, where you can see, like, all right, I see a bullet hole here, I see a bullet hole there. Do you have to, like, shine that laser light through or, like, a little wooden dowel? Do you do that?
We do have the kits for that. We don't have anybody who's certified yet. It takes a long time and a lot of training to get certified, but if ever needed, we can call somebody in, and that's also why we'll do photographs and sketches and whatnot for accurate representation, they can do that.
How much do you have to do with the actual putting together of the evidence to kind of piece together and figure out what happened? Do you have anything to do with that, or do you just collect it all?
We really more just collect it all. I mean, while we're on scene, we'll talk about it, and we have experience with various crime scenes and what's kind of gone on. But in terms of like our actual job, what we'll testify to in court, it's I came, I saw, I picked up.
And that's it.
Yep.
And then from there, it's the detective's job to kind of look and see what you got and piece it all together.
Yep. Because, you know, again, we don't show up in our high heels and then collect the evidence and then go interrogate the suspect and then go back to the lab, and in 40 minutes the crime is solved. So
yeah, it's like TV is so well, the one that blows my mind was the one, what was the guy with the takes the sunglasses off and whatever his name was.
Horatio?
The redheaded guy. Yeah, this
Miami.
Right
here. That's the one.
They Miami. Show up on a crime scene, and they just look at it, and they go, Yep. I see what we got here. Criminal came through that door. Seems like he tripped a little. And they shot him in the back of the head here. You can see the blood splatter here. And then if you look over here, I don't know if you noticed, these papers were a little bit ruffled. Seems like he went out that way. Like,
in 10 seconds, he has the whole effing thing
figured
out.
It's all done. 40 minutes later, the guy's already in prison.
He just looks, and he goes, I got to know exactly what happened.
Hey, look,
there's a trail of blood leading to that mysterious wooded path. I'm going to give that a shot, see if someone's on the other end of it.
It's so ridiculous. Now, and then you watch an episode of First 48, and you realize how far from the truth it is. These guys are spending weeks knocking on doors going, did you see anything? Come on, man. We really need a break. Anybody?
Nope.
Let me make 10, 15, 30 phone calls a day.
Nada.
That's what it really is.
Crime scene Anderson.
Well, I'm wondering, Rachel, how often have you been cleaning up a scene and the guy comes back? Like to try to get some evidence that he left or something like that?
Anyone see a pistol?
When you're there, there's a lot of police presence. Nobody's coming back at that point in time.
For the major scenes, no. We have had instances where
I dropped a huge bag of crack. Anyone seen a bag of crack?
Yeah.
Well, luckily we don't collect that. The police have to collect the money and drugs.
Has anyone seen any money?
But we've had instances where we're processing residential beanies or breaking and entering, and they've had the perpetrator come back, especially if it's been a domestic or something like that. And in that case, we have radios and we can, you know, press a little button and get cops there, or get in the radio and have an officer come back.